Hi, it's Kat here, and you're watching Kat Rose Astrology. And today I'm going to be talking about the Daimon and creativity. It's actually something that I've addressed before on the channel, but that was a while ago and way before I dived headfirst into a heck of a lot of research on the Daimon and wrote a book on the Daimon called Discovering Your Personal Daimon, which you might have heard me jabber on about before. But if you didn't already know, this is a book that will be coming out later in the year, but for now I'm releasing it through Kickstarter, so you can pre-order your copy of the book, get it before everyone else. And I've recently added a hardcover version of the book, and while I'm not necessarily looking forward to shipping it out to everyone, I am looking forward to you getting this in your hands as a physical book. So this is the Kickstarter. At the moment, we've got lots of different rewards you can choose from, so everything from just getting the copy of the book. There's a companion workbook, which is really helpful for the astrology section of the book. There's a two-hour workshop that you can purchase. Like I said, the signed limited edition hardback copy of the book, which I'm really pumped for. What else? We've got the Daimon course. This is a 12-week course that happened earlier in the year, and you can get access to that and learn at your own pace, as well as Daimon readings and Daimon coaching sessions. So all of that, I'm going to put the link in the description of this video. So if you're interested in that, you can check it out on Kickstarter. You've got until the 31st of October. So if you're watching this after that time, after the 31st of October, 2021, then I do recommend looking on Amazon, because hopefully the book will be available on Amazon by then and other more reputable booksellers than the dark lord that is Amazon. Okay, so like I said, I'm going to be talking about creativity and the Daimon today. This is really... it's a topic that's very close to my heart. You know, you might have heard me talk about the Muse before, talk about how the Daimon shows up in creative work. But yeah, much of this section of the book, when I talk more about the Daimon and creativity, was influenced by my earlier research on the Muse, when I was reflecting on, you know, the nature of creativity. Where does it come from? Why is it that so many creatives experience that sense of a piece of work, whether it's a painting, a writing, a song, even dance, it feels like it's not us, that something is coming through us. And that in itself, I think, was a really fascinating thing to explore. And obviously, I thought about the Daimon and how the Daimon, that might be a way of connecting with the Daimon through our creativity. So I'm going to do what I did last week. I'm going to read a little bit out from the book, Discovering Your Personal Daimon. And yeah, if you're interested, obviously you can get the whole copy. And also I'd really appreciate any feedback that you have. Leave a comment below. Tell me what you think about this section of the book. All right, so this comes from part two, where I go through the faces of the Daimon. And this is chapter one, introduction. The Daimon and creativity seem to go hand in hand. Many of us are familiar with that classic image of the artist or writer, or insert your creative passion. Anyone who's driven by the guiding force. Someone who's staying up into the wee hours of the morning, working at their art, fueled by nothing other than this daimonic force. I'm particularly interested in the creative potential for meeting the Daimon, which was also the intention W.B. Yeats had. He believed that the Daimon could give him access to the source from which his poetry flowed. Is a quote from Stephen Daimond. Genuine creativity consists of discovering ways of recognizing, accepting, and making the best use of one's own natural genius, or Daimon. A note to those who aren't creative, and I put like little quotes in the book, but I'll do air quotes for this video. I believe everyone is creative with a big C. So whether you are indeed a traditional creative with a small C in your role as an artist or a writer, musician, or you channel your creativity through your children or work or sport or hobbies, the key is that all of these individuals are using the faculty of imagination to bring forth novel inventions, solutions to the problems and to problems and enrich the world for themselves and others. This is a way to understand your personal Daimon's role in your action in the world and how you might make the most of that relationship to further your creative talent in any field that you're drawn to. How does the Daimon show up for you? So how do we know when the Daimon is guiding our work? Well, this is going to vary from person to person, and we'll go into more of this in part four, in which I cover direct communication and conversation with the Daimon. But for me, It's being in a state of flow, which is best described in the words of Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, the positive psychologist credited with having popularized the concept of flow. He said, in the flow state, my mind isn't wandering. I'm not thinking of something else. I'm totally involved in what I am doing. My body feels good. I don't seem to hear anything. The world seems to be cut off from me. I'm less aware of myself and my problems. And that comes from Csikszentmihalyi's book, Flow. And just a little aside, you might remember I recorded some two podcasts about the topic of flow earlier in 2021. So I think in January, those are the first two podcasts I put out in the year, because the concept of flow had really been fascinating me, particularly in how I could see it reflected in some of the transits that we were having. Anyway, the idea of flow has, over the course of this year, and as I've been writing the book, has really become much more of something that I'm, you know, been dedicating time to and really meditating on, and discovering new ways that I didn't know would be an access route to flow. So if you've heard me talk about my skateboarding, like dabbling, that was another way for me to feel like I was getting into a flow state. Flow for me feels like a time when I hand things over to my personal daimon, who is more than happy to take the reins when I let him. According to Csikszentmihalyi, a flow activity involves the following criteria. One, the activity must have a clear set of goals and an option to progress. This adds direction and structure to the task. Two, the activity must have clear and immediate feedback. This helps us negotiate any changing demands and allows us to adjust our performance to maintain the flow state. This is so true for skateboarding, because if you're not fully focused, you will know very quickly. And finally, we must have a good balance between the perceived challenges of the task at hand and our own perceived skills. In addition, we must have confidence in our ability to complete the task. So if you're doing something and you're like, yeah, this is easy, and I'm like, fine, and you're actually really failing at it, at some point that kind of disconnect is going to throw us out of the flow state. So we need to be able to perceive our own ability or lack of, if in my case with skateboarding. Can I get into this state frequently? No, but do I know what I need in order to get into it? Yes. You could think of these as the unique tuning required for your daimon to come out and play in. Our personal daimons may differ greatly in their requirements from one person to another, though I can also imagine they may share some things in common. So this is where I'm kind of talking about the different optimum states that are daimon, or what we need to get into a flow state. Kind of like talking about them in the same way, what those kind of unique settings are. For example, when I was writing this book, I discovered an entirely new way to get myself into the flow state. I was feeling resistance toward my go-to setting for flow, drawing, and had recently gifted my partner a skateboard. Midlife crises comments aside, I found myself trying out skateboarding for myself. And despite the amount of time I spent eating gravel, I actually found it immensely gratifying. For me, skateboarding is an ideal flow-inducing activity. My daimon may just be a daredevil, but I do think that it hits the mark on all of Csikszentmihalyi's flow criteria checklist. So I've included this as a reminder to experiment. You may not have found your ideal flow state yet, or you may need a new one. So that was kind of why I'm going on about that. What flow settings does your daimon require? Some of us need a very quiet, peaceful workspace. Some of us need music in the background. Some, like Maya Angelou, need to go to a grotty hotel room to write. So I love this story, and I'm going to quote now at length from Maya's own description of this strange need that she has to write. I have kept a hotel room in every town I've ever lived in. I rent a hotel room every few months, for a few months, leave my home at 6 and try to be at work by 6:30. To write, I lie across my bed so that this elbow is absolutely encrusted at the end, just so rough with calluses. I never allowed the hotel people to change the bed because I never sleep there. I stay until 12:30 or 1:30 in the afternoon, and then I go home and try to breathe. I look at the work around 5. I have an orderly dinner, proper, quiet, lovely dinner, and then I go back to work the next morning. Sometimes in hotels, I'll go to the room and there'll be a note on the floor which says, "Dear Miss Angelou, please let us change the sheets. We think they are moldy." but I only allow them to come in an empty waste basket. I insist that all things are taken off the walls. I don't want anything in there. I go into the room and I feel as if all my beliefs are suspended. Nothing holds me to anything. No milkmaids, no flowers, nothing. I just want to feel. And then when I start to work, I'll remember. How does your daimon come to you? So this, I just really loved these particular images by paintings by Caravaggio. They illustrate the different relationships we might have with our daimons. They depict Saint Michael and an angel, or maybe a daimon, guiding him in some way. So the first image, this is the first image that he painted, getting this commission, shows Saint Matthew and the angel intimately close, and with the angel literally guiding the saint's hand. It's incredibly sweet and gentle and feels almost maternal. This painting was rejected for various reasons. For one, being that it didn't fit in with the other paintings in the series, but also because it's clearly controversial if you're a Roman Catholic who's all about divine inspiration, but not direct intervention. Direct intervention is like having the angel guide your hand is considered blasphemous in the church. In the approved painting called The Inspiration of Saint Matthew, Saint Matthew appears to be almost in fear of the angel, or at least subservient to it. The angel is providing inspiration, but the saint knows that he can't delay. His stool is almost falling over because he's clearly rushed to his desk to get this divinely inspired message down. I'm not saying that either of these depictions of the angel or daimon are right or wrong, but one might feel more relatable to you. Do you have this cozy collaborative collaboration going on with your daimon, or do you have this powerful, awe-inspiring force that enters when you least expect it, and you have to rush to capture its gift? Maybe you've experienced both at different times. Again, this is all stuff to consider when you're getting to discover your personal daimon. Okay, so now I'm going to go into the tips that I have, how to create with your daimon. And these are suggestions that are inspired by an article called How to Train Your Daimon by David Paul Kirkpatrick, who's a really interesting character. He's actually the co-founder of the MIT Center for Future Storytelling, president of Paramount Pictures, and production chief of Walt Disney Studios. So he's got a lot of creative titles under his belt. Number one, schedule it. Don't expect the daimon to show up at your beck and call. Like a friend we respect, we wouldn't just call them out of the blue and demand they come talk to us. We arrange when we'll meet and we stick to that arrangement, says the introvert who you must not call unless we have pre-arranged it. Okay, having a schedule or a pre-planned date with your daimon is a way to show the daimon that we honor and respect it and make time for it. Showing up regularly to at least attempt our creative work is like saying, yes, I'm all in, I want this, and I believe the daimon responds kindly to that kind of dedication. That being said, chances are it won't always show up, even if you have. But giving it regular opportunities to show up increases your chances greatly. And it also seems to take the pressure off the daimon and yourself. Number two, open and close your space. Ritualizing the creative space is an important part of working with your daimon. When you let regular life bleed into that space and daimon life bleed into regular life, you can run the risk of diluting both. Here's a quote from Kirkpatrick. It's important to put a lid on it, just as Aladdin did. He called his genie up, and when he was through, Aladdin shut the lamp. As the daimon contains all the polarity found in life, doubt and conviction, light and darkness, rage and rest. You don't want that power hanging around all day. And you don't need to be fancy or elaborate. Some just need to work at the very same spot every time. Light a candle at the beginning and blow it out at the end. You could say a prayer or invocation at the beginning of your work session and share your gratitude at the end. Victor Hugo wrote with his daimon every day after breakfast. He ended his time of inspiration by taking a bath on his rooftop. How nice. I love the book Daily Rituals by Mason Curry, as it shows just how varied and bizarre the routines of creatives are. So that can be a source of inspiration. Number three, incubate. Here's a quote from Kirkpatrick. It is critical to a satisfying life to recognize the sometimes grueling incubation period of creation as a necessary part of the process. There is nothing wrong with you. It is the pressure building before a creative release. Even if we show up every day, we aren't guaranteed a productive romp with the daimon. There may be chunks of our lives where it feels like the daimon is dormant, and this is part of the process. It's possible that astrology can reflect this. Zodiacal releasing is a technique that allows us to study time periods in our lives when the daimon is more or less active. We'll be looking at that technique in part three. Go easy on yourself when the daimon isn't active. It doesn't mean that it's gone away. In fact, you could see it as a time for incubation, a necessary time for development, even if it's still in the egg or cocoon or the soil. Number four, have a life. On that note, when we're not hanging out with a daimon, we need to remember to live our lives. When we're in daimon downtime or not creating, we need to tend to our lives wholeheartedly. No one wants to be around the mopey or snappy creative who just wants to get back to the studio. The daimon can turn demonic if we let it run all over our lives. We need to contain it. And when we're not in the grip of the daimon, we need to tend to our lives. Kirkpatrick gives the example of Michael Jackson, who he spent time with. According to Kirkpatrick, Michael Jackson genuinely believed he was a child, and he built an entire world around it. And while a healthy outlet for a daimon who insisted you were a child might be to go to a theme park, it turns demonic when you live in a theme park and hang out with prepubescent boys. Jackson didn't know how to shut it off. Kirkpatrick said, "It's vital to control the daimon's presence in your life by making a physical entrance and a physical exit to your artistic workspace, as Maya Angelou or Victor Hugo did. To live within the daimon is to blur reality and self-assessment. The need for measured reason with the daimon is blown away by the passion of the muse." And finally, tip five, always be prepared. Even with a regular schedule, the daimon can show up unannounced, regardless of whether we are polite enough not to. Regardless of whether we're polite enough not to. I can spend all morning at my desk waiting for the daimon and trying all kinds of tricks to get it to show up, and nothing happens. And then I'll go for a walk in the nearby woods, and boom, there the elusive daimon is. I have to be prepared for such moments. I usually use my phone to take notes, either written or sometimes voice memos. You can also keep a notebook close at hand. Whatever it is for you, just be prepared. And whatever you do, don't assume you'll remember it by the time you get home. All right, so that's my reading from chapter one, part two, part two, chapter one, which is all about the creative face of the daimon. So I'd be really interested to hear about your experiences with the muse or the creative face of the daimon. Feel free to leave a comment below, or you can even email me hello@catroseastrology.com. And I can't wait for you to get your hands on my book. Like I said, the Kickstarter is running now, and you can pre-order your copy, get an exclusive signed edition, hardback copy of it, and much, much more. I'll put the link in the description below. And yeah, I'll have lots more of these readings coming up over the next few weeks. So if you haven't made up your mind yet, hopefully I'll convince you by those. All right, take care, and I'll catch you next time.